that the highest king would welcome me. I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the sun sets free. Oh, is free.
Thank you. If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice tell the same old lies, and if you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life. There's a better life.
join the Jesus people. If you know your heart belongs.
Give him a little buddy another hand. Wasn't that good? Amen.
I'll get my mic on here in just a minute. It's good to see everybody. If you're a visitor here, you make yourself at home and you worship as the Lord puts on you to worship. Oh, man, that's some awesome singing this morning, ain't it? That gets you going right there. That'll get you in the middle of it. Love it. Love it. We'll let Chris get... There we go. Amen. Woo-wee. That's a nice knock on the door right there. Amen. But it's good to have all of y'all this morning. Family day. Special day. You know, it's been on my heart. I asked the Lord all week. Actually, it's been for 2 weeks that I've been concerned about this message on what he wanted to preach to the family and to the family unit because... You know, with the way things are going right now in our nation and across the world, we're just a little behind everybody else in what they call progressive. But the family's under attack. Amen. The family unit itself is under attack, and we're talking about just what the Bible says is a family unit, not what I say is a family unit, but what Scripture says. And that's the only unit that counts is what Scripture says. And it tells us, you know, plainly in Genesis, and we'll start out in Genesis 1 over there, looking at what the Lord set up. And the Lord had set up for a man and woman to be married. Amen. And he set that up to give children to that man and woman, and he makes a statement to them. Well, I'll just read it to you before we get on into it. Genesis 1 and 27 said, "So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him, male and female created he them. And God blessed them, and God said unto them, Be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it, have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, and over every living thing that moveth upon earth." We have God laying out family, just as simple and plain as it can get. Male and female created he them. And he intended for them to have a life together. I believe this just as sure as he made a helpmeet for Adam, I believe he made a helpmeet for each individual on the face of earth. I do. I trust that to think that he can hang all of the planets in the universe and think that he can't set aside a helpmeet for each one of us would be crazy, isn't it? I don't deny the power of God and what he's able to do in any form, shape, fashion, or the other. But we as a people, a man as a whole, when I say we, I'm talking about encompassing all mankind, we have a habit of perverting things. We have a habit of taking it out. And what it is, it's just Satan and his attack on the family. You know, if you go and you study the Scripture, Satan used a lot of nations and stuff during the time before Christ was to come here to attack and try to attack Israel to keep the king child from being born from heaven that was prophesied. He used many a nation to do it, several nations. And each time, he used a sexual perversion in it, because if you'll look back on history, and you don't have to believe me, look back on the secular history books. They're going to show you the same thing that I'm fixing to tell you that the Bible lays out. Was each time that a civilization or a nation fell, sexual immorality was the beginning of that failure of that nation each time. Things got to be taken out of context on the way God laid it out. Things got to be used in a vulgar manner on the way God laid it out. Things began to be perverted on the way that God laid it out. And the moral depravity that comes with that comes through without the family, without that great foundational background that having a family and having a mom and dad, raising the kids and raising them in the Lord and raising them in a moral standard that is acceptable in the eyes of God, you start to have decay in the whole civilization. And I can show you over and over through, secular history books, where you can study over and over where the perversion of those nations, where the failure, whether it be the fires of Molech where they burnt their children, or whether it be the perversion of the Roman Empire where they thought it was okay to have a male and a female as their companions and stuff. They didn't think nothing about it. I can show you over and over where that began the moral decay, because Satan knows if he can attack the family, then he gets a stronghold in you. If he can attack the family, he gets a stronghold in the nation. If he can attack the family, he pulls people from the Lord. And he knows that. And I'll show you just a little bit. We're going to get on into a family. What's a godly family, I guess, is the way. And when I say a godly family, I'm not lifting up us as godly families. I'm lifting up God as taking care of the family. Amen? He gets all the credit, because in myself is nothing good. In yourself, Don, there's nothing good. There's nothing good in every one of us. So don't think if the Lord's preaching to you this morning, don't think that the preacher's just beating on you about a specific subject, because he's not. I'm just going to use Scripture and let it tell you, and then you can decide through the work of the Holy Spirit in your heart this morning how your family is. Amen? Well, just let the Word do it. But, the Lord laid this out very simple. But by the time we get to the Leviticus priesthood that's over in Moses, the Lord was already sending out great warning on the sexual depravity. And if you think that he's going to hammer on the homosexuality, don't start grinning, because we got a whole list in here that the Bible lists on the things in the family. Amen? But we start out, like I told you, it starts out with sexual depravity. Leviticus 18 and 21. Thou shalt not let any of thy seed pass through the fire of Molech. They were burning their kids. They were burning their children to appease the god Molech. Now surely, any intelligent nation, any godly nation, anybody with any moral compass would not sacrifice their children, would they? We wouldn't put our children to death, would we? We're in the United States. We're smarter than that. We're morally superior than that, right? Just so happens they were burning theirs. We just abort ours before they get here. Amen? Boy, it got quiet. It's a fact, guys. I'm just reading straight out of Scripture on what is happening. When what the Lord is warning, the Levitical priesthood, by the way, this is when God gave the law to the people and said, listen, this is what is separating me and you. This is why I cannot bless your endeavors. This is why I will not keep you safe from the predators. This is why my ear is dull to hearing your prayers and my arm is shortened up. He said, I can reach and get you, but this is what's separating me and you. And he gave the law. Then he gave the priesthood and he said, please teach these principles. Please teach these to the people so that they know and they have me to lean on in their understanding. He says, thou shalt not let any of thy seed pass through the fire of Molech. Neither shalt thou profane the name of God. I am the Lord. Well, anybody profaning the name of the Lord today? I read a survey this morning. There, I just run into it there on some of the United Kingdom news and stuff this morning. For the first time in its history, England, the nation of England, now professes less than half claim to be a Christian in any capacity. Less than half, for the first time in history, a nation whose basis goes back with a strong Christian background, and now they profess less than 40%, and only 33% of them believed in Jesus Christ. Glory to God, I don't know what the other 7% is supposed to be believing in at that 40%. If they don't believe in Jesus, they ain't a Christian. But we see, again, we're just a hair behind those progressive nations and what they do. Thou shalt not lie with mankind as with womankind. It is an abomination. I think that's as plain as English as can be spoken. Do y'all? Does anybody have any question on what he said right there? A man should not lie with a man, nor a woman with a woman. It is an abomination in the eyes of God. Not my opinion, straight out of Leviticus chapter 18, verse 22. That's not preacher speak. That's what God said for you priests to preach to the children of Israel. Do you think he's changed his mind? No, he has not. He goes further and he says, neither shalt thou lie with any beast to defile thyself therewith. Neither shall any woman stand before a beast to lie down thereto. It is confusion, he says. Confusion to who? To your children? Y'all think we got any confused children right now in the schools? Y'all think we have any children that don't know? They don't know the Scripture because Scripture's been hidden from them. They're told, hey, whatever gratifies you is okay. Whatever gives you joy, it's okay. If you confess to be this, that's what you are. Well, where, I ain't even gonna go there. It leads to confusion to our babies. They do not understand what God so plainly laid out and what is so beautiful. What is so beautiful that God laid out? And if you think that, Brother Darrell, that's Old Testament, that's over the hill, that's done with. Well, let's go to New Testament. Let's listen to what he told Paul to teach to the Romans. Remember the Romans that I just mentioned? That the hierarchy, the generals, the centurions, and all of them thought, hey, I need 15 women and I need me 15 boys, and that'll sexually gratify me. That's what they thought. Hey, it was a societal thing. It was accepted. Unfortunately, stuff like this is more and more accepted each and every day right here in the United States. Guys, it's wrong in the sight of God. Don't matter what I think about it. It is wrong in His sight. That's what matters. If it goes against the precepts and the teachings of God, I don't care what the government says. I don't care what an activist says. I don't care what anyone else says. They don't judge you in the end. They're not the ones that will condemn you in the end. They don't matter what they say. What matters is what thus saith the Word of God. It doesn't matter what anyone else thinks. Romans 1 and 21. We'll go New Testament. Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. We have people that stand in government offices today. We have doctors that will stand in front of you professing to be wise that cannot give you the definition of a woman. Congregation, you can say amen because that's a fact. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. Glory to God. I'm not railing on them. I know who's behind all this. I know where this attack comes from. My battle ain't with that activist. My battle ain't with that doctor. My battle ain't with that person that's hung out in the sexual perversion. My battle's with the devil. And this is the attack on the family that we're going through right here. Don't forget where we started in the sermon. But then 23, it said they changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like to corruptible man, and to birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things. Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts, to dishonor. Now listen, he ain't changed his mind. To dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie, and worshiped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. Not the creature, the Creator is blessed forever. Amen. For this cause, God gave them up to vile affections. You've heard me preach it before. You stay with it long enough, you live in it long enough, He'll turn you over and let you have your way. And I hope you're prepared for all of the reward that it will earn. Because the wages of sin is death. You need to understand that. If you want to go that path, go. Go. But just understand that that path leads to death. You must know that. It'd be unfair for you not to know that. Who changed the truth of God into a lie, worshiped and served Creator more, the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed of God. 25, 26. If you're lost, I'm in Romans 1. I'm at verse 26. For this cause God gave them up to vile affections, for even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. What's the natural use? The woman with the man, just like we covered in Genesis 1 and 27. That's the natural use. You don't like what I'm preaching? Talk to God. He wrote this, not me. Amen. And likewise, also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust one toward another. Men with men, working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error which was meet. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, none of these want to be told this is sin. Don't want to retain God in their knowledge. Again, okay, I get it, but I'm going to warn you until he takes my last breath. So you cannot stand before him and say, well, that brother there in that pulpit at Pleasant Hill on Family Day did not tell me. It won't be on my hands. But now we say, boy, he is hammering it home on the homosexuality. Now let's listen. Let's listen a little closer here. God gave them over to reprobate mind, to do those things which are not convenient. I told you, when the family starts being attacked and it starts going by the wayside and sexual perversion comes in, there's a lot comes with that. Are you listening? He just covered sexual perversion. Now here's what he said is going to happen. After that comes in, he said people start to look and say that God is not real. God doesn't control what I do. God don't look at my sin that way. God don't do this or do that. Yes, he does. We done covered it in the scripture. But here's what comes with sexual immorality. Verse 29 said that people will be filled with unrighteousness. People will be filled with fornication. I have news for you, church. This is for all of us. We look at homosexuality, sex, and we think that's the most horrible thing in the world. If you're having sex right now with anyone outside of the bonds of matrimony, you're just as guilty of hellfire as that person is that's a homosexual. You hear me? If it's done outside the bonds of marriage, it is called fornication. It's listed right here. So don't think that anybody's higher than the next, because we're not. But this is the type of things that come when we start being sexually perverse. The people are filled with unrighteousness. People are filled with fornication. People are filled with wickedness. This is the Bible, not Brother Darrell. This is God's Word, verse 29. They're filled with covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy. They're filled with murder. They're filled with debate. They're filled with deceit, malignity. They're whisperers. They're backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful. It all starts with the breakdown of the family. It all starts with sexual perversion. You can start adding all of these things come to that nation. We're seeing that it's in its fulfillment. We're seeing it in its fulfillment now. We got people that want to let the kids have their way. Uh-uh. Mamas and daddies, the Lord set you up. He blessed you with children to lead them in a godly manner. Amen. Not let them have their way in sexual perversion. Amen. He blessed you with those children to teach them in the correct way. And the government now is working overtime, trying its best to take away the parents' authority over the child. Amen. How's that going to go? We're not seeing enough damage right now. We're not seeing enough damage in the household that mom and daddy ain't present. We're not seeing enough damage in our society already. Can we not see plainly what it means when the family unit is broken? It affects everyone. And God bless our children. Man, I know they got to be confused. Don't let your babies be confused. Teach them the scripture. Not so they go to school and look down on somebody and tell them how sorry they are. That has got nothing to do with it. It's so they can live in the sight of God and be a teacher to those that don't understand Him and don't know Him. Not so they can go be judge over somebody, but so they can be a light. It goes on and said, those folks will know the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only to do the same, but have pleasure in them. It says that it will get to a point in a society that started with sexual perversion, that the people will know what God says, will simply deny it, know that it's going to send them to hell, and they'll do it anyway. See how easily it happens when Satan attacks the family. When he tells them, it's okay, have as many children as you want outside of wedlock, that's fine. Daddies, you don't have to be there to raise your kid. You don't have to be a part of their life, daddies. Satan, man, he's good at that stuff. He's good. Mamas, you don't worry about it. You carry him over at grandma's house and you go party. See what happens? See what happens to our babies? Listen, what we're talking about right here, all these things that people become is what our children become. Let's give them a chance. Let's teach them about Jesus. Let's teach them about the way He said. Let's teach them about the beauties of marriage. Let's teach them about the beauties of a man and woman making a home and making a family that's safe, that can come and be taught about the Word of God, be taken to church, be told no when it's not good for them, be told yes when it is. Amen. Genesis 2 and 24 says, therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. Glory, is that not beautiful? That a man and woman, that God can grow a man and woman so closely that they literally become one flesh. It's so beautiful. During the time of Job's trial, think about this. When Satan was bringing about all these trials, God allowed it. Matter of fact, God broke Job up first. He said, Satan, you've been down there checking out Job, ain't you? He said, I tell you what, that's a devout man right there. Satan said, no, he'll curse you. Let me take away what he's got and see what happens. Did y'all notice that Job lost everything but one thing? His wife. Two had become one. He told Satan, he said, keep your hands off of Job for a while. Remember, later on there was some boils and some things, but he never touched that woman. Two had become one. See, there's beauty in this. Have y'all thought about this, that when Noah, listen, a devout family, listen to me. When God saved Noah from the flood, who did he save with him? His family. Amen? When God saved the harlot Rahab at the time when the walls of Jericho were going to crumble, who did he save with her? Her family. Amen. Ain't that pretty good? When he took Abraham, when he took him up out of Haran down there, who did he take with him? His family. You don't think family ain't important to God the Father? He knows how precious family is. Floyd Baker, I heard this in the last couple of weeks, think come out of Floyd's mouth. Floyd, as we know, had a medical emergency. You know what was on his mind? Glory. This is just chill bump material right here. You know what was on his mind when he was in there, when he didn't know if he was going to regain consciousness? And he'll tell you. He'll tell you what I'm telling you is correct. He didn't get to tell his family bye. That was what was on his mind. That's precious. Amen. We seen it this week with the scrambling with Michael Yancey's family. Family is important. Not only to me and you, but to God. He ordained it, guys. Oh my goodness, look at what we've been given. Let's don't let it be shambles. Let's don't let it be a wreck. That child that you're raising is a direct gift from God. Listen, Psalm 127:3 says, "Lo, children are a heritage of the Lord, and the fruit of the womb is His reward." That baby is your precious, precious child that God gave you. You make sure it's got a chance. You make sure that that baby knows about Jesus. You protect that baby. You bring that baby up in a family that is together. Let's look at a little bit more right here. When God saved Cornelius, that's another one I had wrote down. If you all remember, Cornelius was a devout man. He had prayed to God in the prayer, come into God because he was a devout man. He had faith in God. He had faith in God the Father. And when Cornelius was saved, who else was saved with him? His family. It wasn't because Cornelius got saved that the Lord said, well, your family's going to be saved just because you did it. God knew down the road that, hey, that man right there, saved by grace, that devout man, he's going to teach them my word. My word has the power unto salvation in it. It's going to dig in, and that man's kids and wife's going to be saved. Man, think about it. When God saved Lydia, y'all remember Lydia, seller of purple? When he saved Lydia, who got saved with her too? Family. See how this works? Pretty neat, ain't it? It's pretty neat when you devote things to God. If we'll take care of what's important to God, if we'll honor and glorify Him, He'll take care of what's important to us. Guarantee you. But what's a godly family? Number one, a godly family has faith. That's first. You can't be a godly family unless you have faith in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. We're not godly in any form, shape, fashion, or manner. We're dirty, folks. But if we put our faith in Jesus Christ, He is faithful and just to forgive us. Is that not what it says, Brother David? This man's preached the word many times. He made that promise to us, didn't we? Put our faith in Him and I'll forgive you of your sin and save you from hell. Ain't that what He told us? Amen, but a family will have faith. And I was looking in F.F. Bruce, it's Franklin Fiery Bruce. He was a seminary professor. I've always, this verse has always threw me a little bit. Y'all going to recognize it. Hebrews 11:1. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. For by it the elders obtained a good report. Through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. Well, that's kind of word speaking. It's kind of confusing, isn't it? Well, F.F. Bruce really simplified it. I loved it. He said, just like our eyes produce evidence to me that Jeff Copeland is sitting right there. My eyes produce that evidence. My faith produces evidence right here that Jesus Christ has forgiven me. Amen. Ain't that a good way to look at it? It's the faith Through faith, I know. I don't have to question. I don't have to doubt. I know Jesus Christ exists. I know He's the Son of God. I know He died on the cross. I know He's in heaven at the right hand of the Father. And I know He forgives me. Faith.
Amen.
Ain't that good? Ain't that good? So first, Jesus must be the center of our life for our family. He's got to be the focal point of our family. If He's not the focal point, you got Him positioned in the wrong place. If He's not the focal point, you're missing the greatest blessing of all. Put Jesus in His proper place. Have faith in Him above all things. Amen? That way we can start leading our kids and stuff. Genesis 18. Oh, Abraham again. Seeing that Abraham shall surely become a great mighty nation, and all the nations of the earth shall be blessed in him. For I know him that he will command his children and his household after him, and they shall keep the way of the Lord to do justice and judgment, that the Lord may bring upon Abraham that which he has spoken of him. Did y'all hear that? God said, I know. That's a man of faith. I know he's going to teach his kids. I know he's going to lead them to me. And I will do what I have told Abraham I would do. I will make him the father of many nations. Amen. Isn't that a promise? That's a promise to me and you. God will take care of your family. There's people out here saying, well, now sometimes, you know, family dies. Leanne Brad's been through it. I've been through it. And there's several more in here. Me and my wife been down that road. There's several more in there. Let me tell you something. I believe this with every fiber of my being. Adam went out at 28 years old, and I am firmly convinced that God done what was best for my son. He didn't have to come and ask me because I couldn't see down the road like he can. He didn't have to come and ask Susie. And while it hurts, I am convinced with every fiber of my being that God took my son home with him because he knew he needed to get him right then.
Amen.
And there ain't a doctor alive that could have kept him alive if God wants him. And there ain't nobody that can kill him if God wants him to stay here.
Amen.
I have faith in God in that manner. Amen. Amen. God will take care of our family. He will take care of them. You teach them about Jesus. Acts 10 and 1 tells us about this guy, Cornelius. It said, Cornelius, a centurion of the band called the Italian Band, was a devout man, one that feared God with all his house, which gave much alms to the people and prayed to God always. He saw in a vision, evidently about the ninth hour of day, the angel of God coming into him and saying to him, Cornelius, he said, Cornelius, get up. There's a guy down there called Peter. I want you to go get him. He said, go get him, Cornelius. Peter had a dream. That was when he dreamed about sheep coming down. You remember? And he thought something might be uncommon. It's when those Gentiles was going to get saved. Hey, I'm part of that tribe. I'm the tribe of the Gentiles. Amen? See, Cornelius had faith in what the Word of God said. And he was devout in that faith. And look what happened with his family. Amen? You know, here's what's neat about Cornelius' story, and this just kind of hit me. I'm going to share it with you right quick. Cornelius was a Roman. Most of the Jews despised the Romans. They kept them under bondage. They kept them subdued. Do you know Cornelius, it says, got along and had great honor among the people? The Lord will make enemies. Footstool. Amen. Amen. Ain't that right? That's a promise. A family of God will have faith in Jesus Christ. Second thing they'll have, they're going to have love. You know, my mom and dad, my cousin sitting back there, Roger, he'll tell you, my mom and dad was good people. They were. But now daddy wasn't one to come up and tell you he loved you. Mama really wasn't. Mama would tell you, if you forced the subject, told her first, she'd tell you. And every now and then, if she thought you were upset with her about something, she'd, Daryl Anthony, you know I love you. Yeah, I can tell, Mama. Well, you just blistered me. I can tell you love me from one side to the other. I got the marks to prove it. Look. But Mama and Daddy, they hated me compared to the way Jesus loves me. Amen. And the only way that I can share the love of Jesus with my family is I must be saved by grace, and I must have the love of Christ in me. Then I'll have a general idea how to share it. I ain't real good at it. But I knew my mom and daddy. They did. They loved me. Mom and daddy, they raised me well. Daddy didn't kill me nowhere along the way when he probably should have a few times. Amen. But Jesus Christ loves you in the condition that you're sitting there in this morning. Amen. He loves you exactly like you are, and he just wants you to put your faith in him. And if you'll do that, the love of God will pervade your family because you can't help but share with that family. How easy is it for you to share with a lost member of your family? Anybody? How easy? Man, we talk to people about the Lord down on the streets. We run into them at the gas station, at the line at Walmart. And we tell them about Jesus Christ. We go home with a family member that's lost and stuff because they know so much about our past. We're scared to death. Same thing to them, I believe. I don't nobody know me hardly any better than them two sitting back there. Roger and my wife sitting right behind him. And they still love me. Hey, Jesus loves me even more. He loved me when I was unlovable. Yet while I was out in sin, he commended his love toward me. Right? And forgave me of my sin. And he'll do the same for you. But you got to have love in your family. Listen to this. In 1 Corinthians 13, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, and have not charity. The word charity is love here. Just when you hear charity, think love. But if I have not charity, I am become as a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. I may be loud, but I'm false. That's what it's saying. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains and have not love, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned and have not love, it profiteth me nothing. And it goes on. And it talks about it. Without love, you got to love. But guys, listen to me. Parents, young parents. Tough love is love too. Amen. Tough love is love too. And I caution you over and over because I know for a fact that I can look back on things that I've done, particularly with Amber and Adam. I never had to just stay after Amber. I really didn't. Amber was a lot like Zadie, I'm telling you. She read that scripture at home. She read and she read and she read and she stayed in those things. Adam, oh man. Reading anything outside of a magazine about a stereo system was tough to get him to do, including his math, his English, his science, his history. All those things. It's like World War III, right? But I look back on some things that I should have told Adam, no, you're not going there. No, you're not taking part in that. I see things that I should have told Amber, no, you're not going to take part in that. Not because I wanted to deprive them of anything, but simply because I loved them and I wanted to keep them from some things that was harmful. Amen? And I didn't step in when I should have. If you love your child, I've used this analogy before. If they were walking into a minefield, you would tackle them, you would hold them down, you would do whatever it took. You would tie ropes around their legs if you had to. You would do anything and everything. No matter how badly they wanted to go into that minefield, you would do it. You would keep them out of it. You would give your life to keep them out of that minefield. Well, why don't we do the same thing for them to keep them out of the minefield that Satan's got planted on their spiritual life? Amen. Why don't we do those things that we need to do to keep them out of it? If you love them, you will. Amen. Love. Family's got to have faith and they got to have love. And the last one, and y'all go ahead and be getting set up. It's going to be doing the, I know Leanne, you got, y'all come on. Y'all come on. Seven, come on up because y'all going to do a couple of songs. Come on where we don't have a lot of movement going on in altar call. The third thing, and there's many things we can write down in marriage, but these things the Lord really just put on my heart to preach to you. And that's we must have faith in Christ. He's got to be the focal point. We must have the love of Jesus in our family. Number three, we must be committed. We must be committed, and that's to Him first and to our family right behind it. We must be committed to support our family. You know, I too many times I see it now where families are broke apart and they really don't have a lot of commitment to each other. And Satan's really good at putting a little wedges in there between people. He'll do it over money. He'll do it over something said. He'll do it over something that was divvied out at mama's funeral, daddy's funeral. He'll do it over all kinds of stuff. You name it, and he can cause division in family. But we gotta be a committed family. Pleasant Hill. And visitors, we welcome you into service with the Pleasant Hill family. We're so glad to have you. Pleasant Hill, we gotta be committed to each other. We gotta be supportive. We gotta hold each other accountable. That's that tough love. We gotta step up. Michael, you gotta step up to the pastor. You see him going down the wrong way. You gotta step up and say, Brother Darrell, man, what's going on? Ain't right. It ain't biblical, Brother Darrell. What you're doing right now is not right. You gotta be willing Amen. To do that. If you Amen. Love me, you'll do that. You'll commit Amen. To that. Amen. We gotta be committed to each other. Abraham, we're gonna use him right quick. And there came one that had escaped and told Abram the Hebrew, and he dwelt on the plain of Mamre, the Amorite, and his brother Eshcol and his brother Aner, and these were confederate with Abraham. And when Abram heard that his brother was taken captive, it's actually his nephew. Lot has been taken captive. The kings of Chedorlaomer and all of that crew that's fighting, five kings on four, they're fighting. They've come along down there at Sodom. They've took Lot. They took Lot's family. They took all those. They took all of the possessions that was down there, and they took off with them. Abram didn't sit back and say, well, boy, I hope somebody will go help Lot. That's my nephew. I hope somebody will go down there. No, Abraham got up, and he got 300 of his best, and he tore out after those kings. He tore out after those great armies. He went down there for Lot. When Lot had already chosen Sodom, listen to me. When Lot had chosen to live down there at Sodom, Abram didn't say Lot got himself into that situation. He get himself out. He loaded up his crew and he took off and he went and rescued him. And there's something that you need to get out of this. On his way back, they're bringing back all kinds of spoils and stuff with them from those kings. And they met somebody on the road. They met this chief priest. His name was Melchizedek. And if you studied him just a little bit in Scripture, he is one more unique individual. He's the high priest of the high priest. He's nothing less than Jesus Christ incarnate in the Old Testament. And he gives him 10% of the spoils. Y'all remember? But y'all remember old Melchizedek come out to let old Abram know, well done, my good and faithful servant. Amen. When you have commitment, the Lord looks on you and says, well done, my good and faithful servant. He didn't look down on old Lot and the things that he got into. We see Abraham later on. Y'all remember what he done. He rose up early one morning. He saddled up his ass out there with the saddle. He laid the firewood over there and he told his two men with him. He said, come on, me and the boy is going up on the mountain to pray. He carried the boy up on the mountain. He laid him down on the altar and was fixing to sacrifice him to God. He was so committed to God, he is going to sacrifice that firstborn that was born when he was up there at 100 years old and his wife was 90. He is going to sacrifice that kid because he is so committed to God. And God said, no, you had faith, brother. Look right over there. There's a ram and it's perfect. Won't you sacrifice it? God took care of his family. Amen. One more time, because the man was committed. Jesus walked by the Sea of Galilee. He walked by and this old boy down there, these big old forearms, there's two of them. One was named Simon Peter. Then the other one's named Andrew. He told him, he said, guys, drop your nets. Follow me. They didn't ask questions. The Lord's going to ask you in a few minutes to follow me. What are you going to do? You going to keep mending your net that's reaping in all that sin? Or are you going to come to the altar when he says, follow me? Where's your commitment this morning? As a rich young man come to Jesus one time, he said, what must I do to be saved? Jesus told him about the commandments. He said, well, I've kept them since I was a kid. Listen, Because somebody's going to walk out of here as a rich man that's got the riches of the world. Or somebody can come like old Simon Peter and Andrew did, say, I don't understand where he's going. I don't know what he's fixing to do. I just trust that man, so I'm going to drop my net and I'm going to follow him. I'm tired of pulling in what the world's offering. I want what he's got, amen? I want what that one right there's got, so I'm just going to set my stuff aside and I'm going to put my faith in him. Are you going to walk out those doors or go right up that hall? You going to sit down and eat just as lost as you was when you walked in the house while the Lord's knocking on your heart saying, follow me. Lord told that rich young ruler, he said, just drop everything you've got. That's all he's asking you to do this morning. Drop everything that you've been trusting in if you've not trusted in Jesus Christ. Just throw it down. It's useless. It's as useless as them nets were to Peter and Andrew. Them boys been fishing all night and ain't caught nothing. Jesus said, just put it down and won't you follow me? That's what he's asking you. When we have this altar call, what are you going to do? Do you want your family to be a family raised in faith, in love, and in commitment? Daddies, it starts with you. Like it or not, daddies, it starts with you. Mamas, it continues right through you. Are you going to be like that rich young ruler? The Lord said, just put it all down. Just put it to the side and follow me. And it said that boy walked away sorrowful. Walked away sorrowful. And we have no other information about that young man, but we do find somebody crying out in hell later on that was a rich young ruler. Some theologians say it was a different one. I don't believe it was a different one. I believe it was this same young man. We find him crying out in hell. He's begging Father Abraham to send somebody with a drop of water to put on his tongue. That's where we find him the next go round. Guys, I love you. Y'all are an awesome group. Y'all brothers and sisters in Christ, y'all my family. You are my family. Jesus, your Lord and Savior, me and you are brothers or we're brother and sister. It's one of the two. Let's make sure that we're committed in faith to Christ. We're committed in love to Him and to our family. And we have that final commitment to raise our children in the ways of the Lord. Would you please do that as we celebrate Family Day? As they sing, won't you come to your feet? Come on, keep coming. Any shortcomings in that? Come on. Come on, you ain't going to be alone. They've got people that's got a lot of stuff they want to pray about. Come on. If you're up top, you're not too far. Come on. Come on. Thank you.
outside looking in. This is where grace begins. We were hungry, we were thirsty, with nothing left to give. Oh, the shape that we were in. Just when all hope seemed lost, love opened the door for us. He said, come to the table. Come join the sinners who have been redeemed. Take your place beside the Savior. Sit down and be set free. Come to the table. Come meet this motley crew of misfits, these liars and these